California and Chile have good wine too.
But then he goes and stocks the pantry with nothing but French wine from 72. This stuff is a disaster, then he says. Come on, Cécile, have a taste of the old country. I had a terrible feeling about it, so I decided just to taste it at first. And then again. And then a few more times.
Took one for the team, huh? But when you do a tasting, don't you usually spit the wine out?
But bottle after bottle, nothing but garbage. Absolute garbage. Not one half-decent bottle in the whole lot. Taste of the old country, he says.
Sorry to hear that.
Ugh, I cannot believe this. What will we do with all this wine?
The guys aren't too picky when it comes to taste.
Ugh, you sound just like Monsieur Miller.
Huh?
When I complained, he simply said, as long as it gets the job done. You people are such culinary savages. Allez-vous faire voir? Somebody take me back to Paris, please.
I think you've had a little too much, Cécile.
Wenn dieser ganze Wein doch Müll ist, warum trinkt sie dann so viele Pullen davon?
You seem like a very, how do I put this, uninhibited woman.
You think so? I am no different from other Parisian women. Not since May 1968.
May 1968? The general strike that almost brought down the president?
Right. But it was more than just a strike. It started with the student movement at Strasbourg University in 66. They did not want anything from the country, but instead sought reform at the school. That helped ignite a fire in the hearts of scores of dissatisfied young people. And the movement spread all over France. It was more than just opposition to Vietnam and the de Gaulle administration. People also called for free love and the breaking away from other old values. Looking back, I am not sure what the main goal really was. But whatever the case, it was more of a young people's movement than a strike or a protest.
So, it was like the hippies or something?
In some ways, perhaps. But we weren't blinded by mysticism, nor did we seek a return to nature.
I see. So, while they wanted to retreat to their closed communes,
we tried to change the world. And in doing so, we learned that when everyone comes together, it can be done.
You had a lot more success. In America, hippies have just become a social problem, while I hear Japan's student movements crashed and burned.
I wonder what was different.
Good question. I'd like to know myself.
Ja, wahrscheinlich bessere Prävention, um so etwas überhaupt erst anfangen zu lassen. Aber naja, so, jetzt gehen wir Richtung Strangelove, da haben wir eine ganze Menge.
AI stands for Artificial Intelligence. It refers to a man-made machine possessing an intellect on par with that of a human being.
Is that even possible?
Possible. You've seen it with your own eyes. What the AI weapons are capable of. How Peacewalker carried out the boss's will in the end. No mere machine could ever choose to sacrifice itself like that.
I just can't see how a bunch of circuits and switches could have a will of its own.
It's called the ghost in the machine, Snake. And it exists.
Ach, wirklich beängstigend, wenn wir an heute denken, ne?
What did you mean by the ghost in the machine?
Oh, that. It's a term coined by the philosopher Gilbert Ryle. You've heard of Descartes, yes?
I think therefore I am.
That is the one. Descartes espoused the dualistic theory of mind and body. He believed that our thinking minds exist in a separate dimension from our bodies, which are governed by the laws of physics. But if that were true, then couldn't you say that a mechanical body, inhabited by a ghost mind, is a human being? Ryle criticized Descartes on those grounds, saying such a thing surely wouldn't be human.
Why'd you bring it up?
I wasn't thinking of Ryle in particular when I said it. I simply thought that If a person is composed of a machine and a ghost, perhaps the opposite is true as well. Perhaps by placing a ghost inside a machine, we could, in effect, give birth to a new person.
And that was your idea for the boss AI?
The moment you ripped the memory board out, the mammal pod ceased to function. It should have been dead. And yet, Peace Walker righted itself, singing a song of peace. I couldn't help but feel that her soul had come to inhabit Peace Walker.
Und damit bewies der Boss ihre Unschuld. Wenn auch als Geist in der Maschine, ne, aber das ist ja schon das, was dahinter steckt.
Let's say, hypothetically, there really was an intelligent machine. How would you prove it? What's the difference between a high-level computer and an AI?
It depends on what you choose to define as intelligence. For example, Snake, listen to my voice talking to you now. Suppose it were an AI.
Say what?
What if the living, breathing me sitting here drinking tea and talking to you were actually an AI, programmed to simulate my thoughts and my voice?
You're nuts.
No, I'm not. You couldn't prove I was a real human being, could you?
No.
So if an AI is so advanced you can't tell it from the real thing, wouldn't you call that intelligence?
I'm not quite convinced.
But that's only one way to look at it. It's roughly how Dr. Turing explained artificial intelligence. The test I described is called the Turing test, in his honor.
Yeah, well, sounds like a bad joke to me. That singing monster of yours put me through hell. If I never meet one again, it'll be too soon.
Shame. And I was about to let an AI take my place in our conversation.
Don't even think about it.
Besser nicht. Ja, dieser Turing-Test, naja, haben wir sogar als nächstes hier. Brauche ich gar nichts dazu sagen.
Dr. Alan Turing is known as the father of computer science. It was he who formulated the basic theory of AI. During the war, he worked for GC&CS.
The government's cryptology school. The one that broke Enigma.
The very same. Without him, they might never have been able to decipher the German's code. But then, they arrested him.
Why? Weren't his some of the greatest contributions to winning the war?
Homosexuality was a crime in Britain back then, and he was gay. I know exactly how crushed he was. I feel it's my duty to further his AI research.
Like the imitation game, huh?
Huh. You know it then. The clue that inspired the Turing test came from a trifling little party game. You exchange written notes with another person behind a screen and try to guess their gender, whether they're a woman or a man, pretending to be a woman. It's surprisingly difficult to tell the difference, man or woman, human or machine. What do the differences even mean? Dr. Turing was fascinated by the differences between men and women. Perhaps that's what led him to formulate his test.
Ja, und ich kenne tatsächlich ein Date-Café, was mit diesen Tests arbeitet, aber egal. Ich war da nie.
What do you mean?
If the end goal is MAD, it seems like there are more suitable models out there. A military chief of staff, or a nuclear technician, even the president.
Patriotism, leadership, good judgment. Each of those qualities is essential when deciding whether to launch a nuke, and she had them all.
Wouldn't the president too?
It's not enough. She had the will for it.
Will?
Let me explain, Snake. Peace Walker is a standalone weapon. It has to decide on its own whether or not to launch a nuke. It can't turn to anyone else for advice. It can't do its job if it's not prepared to take sole responsibility for the fate of the world. I know of no other human being who could bear that burden.
That's it.
There were technical considerations, of course. To begin with, the female brain is a more appropriate model for an AI.
Wait, the female brain?
Da wollen wir doch mal genauer nachhaken.
What do you mean by that, modeling your AI after the female brain?
Snake, what is the human mind capable of that a computer is not?
Being lazy?
Interesting response. And not incorrect. But the answer I was looking for was empathy.
Empathy?
The ability to feel for others, to be more precise. Love for a child. Pity for the weak. Grief for the dead. All of these are particularly well developed in the female brain.
That's stretching it a little.
On the contrary, it's perfectly reasonable. The male brain, on the other hand, may be well suited for systematic thinking, but it's less able to empathize. In that sense, it's closer to a computer. So if your objective is to make the AI think more like a human...
You need to teach it how to empathize like a woman.
The novel, Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep, deals with this very problem. In the book, an empathy test is used to distinguish between machines and human beings. As machines become more and more advanced, our society will gradually become more and more systematic. Our cities will teem with robot-like people, unable to feel for others. We cannot allow that to happen. Computers must learn to empathize. The same goes for humans, only more so.
Well, what about yourself? You make these claims, and yet I've never seen you empathize with a real person.
It's true. Until now, I was a prisoner of death. It was my intention to die upon the completion of Mammal's development. She was my one reason to live.
But you changed your mind.
I did. Because she taught me the dignity of living. My eyes are open now. I want to go on living and seeing real people.
Huh. I see.
Ja, dieses Buch Träumen an Ruinen von elektrischen Schafen ist übrigens auch die Vorlage für den Film Blade Runner. Das nur nebenbei gemerkt, aber egal.
Is it necessary to make machines think like humans? I think empathy would get in the way of making the decision to retaliate.
I admit, human thought may not be fully compatible with level-headed decision making. Then again, is there such a thing as non-human thought? The moment computers became so advanced that they could calculate faster than human beings, a new dream was born.
Dream?
If we can create a machine that can do advanced mathematics, why can't we create one that can think like a human? The 19th century author, Auguste Villiers-l'Isle-Adam, wrote a book called Tomorrow's Eve, in which the protagonist fashions an artificial woman to serve as his ideal lover. I believe the idea of creating an intelligent being with our own hands is one of mankind's oldest dreams.
So AI is a product of people's dreams, then?
Not only AI, civilization itself is the process by which mankind gives form to its dreams. But not all dreams are pleasant. Some have expressed fears about non-human intelligence.
Yeah, they want the benefits with none of the risks.
Some fear that intelligent robots might rise up and rebel against their human masters, as portrayed by the Czech writer Karel Čapek in his Rossum's Universal Robots, or in the 1970 film Colossus, The Forbin Project, where intelligent supercomputers in the US and the Soviet Union join forces and plot to subjugate humanity. Isaac Asimov offered a specific solution to these fears with his Three Laws of Robotics, which demonstrated that while robot intelligence is different from that of humans, the two can coexist. In order to endow computers with intelligence, we must first have a thorough understanding of what intelligence is, and that is where the need for a practical and feasible expert system arises.
Ja, gibt zu viele Beispiele, auf denen diese Arbeit da basiert.
So what's an expert system?
The AI housed within Peace Walker began development as such a system. An expert system is a type of proxy program by which a computer makes decisions as an expert would. The program, Mycin, for example, is a system that decides which kind of antibiotics to prescribe. The system asks the patient a series of questions to narrow down the range of appropriate drugs.
So you program Peace Walker to prescribe live nuclear warheads instead of penicillin?
What I realized, however, was that a simple expert system wasn't up to the task.
You need more than expertise to launch a nuke.
Indeed. Expertise is a necessary prerequisite, but insufficient on its own. Deciding to launch a retaliatory strike requires consideration of a wider range of factors, In such a scenario, the entire global situation becomes the criterion for making a decision.
Makes sense. You screw up the prescription and the whole world goes into anaphylactic shock.
A weak AI that only has a limited range of knowledge upon which to base its decisions won't cut it. Therefore, I had the AI study the boss's thought patterns, thus creating a true expert system. A strong AI.
You couldn't leave the world in the hands of something with anything less than absolute worldview.
I could have built a simple expert system in no time at all. Say, how would you like a system that decides which guns you should equip according to the mission's parameters?
I'll pass. I'm not going to leave my life up to somebody else's judgment. Especially not a machine.
Naja, warten wir mal ein bisschen ab und ob er dann immer noch die gleiche Meinung hat.
With current technology, AI are inevitably enormous in size. But as circuit integration continues to advance, they will become even smaller. As small as human brains, and perhaps smaller than that. And in the meantime, robotics will continue to advance as well, to the point where we can create androids, robots that resemble humans. And then...
And then what?
Well, I don't need to spell it out for you, do I?
Don't tell me you're thinking of making an android imitation of the boss.
Surely the thought has crossed your mind as well. Of one day being reunited with her?
Enough! I don't want any part of it.
I see. I didn't mean to offend you. In reality, AI is more likely to evolve in the opposite direction anyway.
Ja, dass sie Arbeit verrichten soll, nicht wahr?
The opposite direction. What does that mean?
More and more, AI are becoming systems that specialize in mass information processing, without
yep.
human intelligence, thought, or emotion. A machine that has no individualism or sense of self, but rather behaves as a collective, exhibiting the qualities of a society.
Like a beehive.
Yes, it aggregates data collected by individuals and determines how the collective will act. Just as honeybees travel between the hive and flowers. The key to achieving that will be networking AI together.
I don't know how to say this, but that kind of gives me the creeps.
But if your goal is to control society, it's the better model to use. It lets you filter data, disseminate only what you want disseminated. Of course, I myself have no interest in an AI without a shred of life to it.
Das klingt schon zu stark nach Arsenal Gear, oder? Naja.
Earlier, you called the mammal pod a butterfly. Not a pupa or a cocoon, but an imago.
Yes, the AI that came before the mammal pod were works in progress.
Works in progress?
They were enough to keep the frame running, but not enough to make decisions about nuclear retaliation. They weren't quite complete. They were pupae. Only when I added the boss's data did the AI take on its true form, becoming a butterfly and taking flight.
And that's why the Nozard on Peace Walker was a butterfly.
I gave the mammal AI the codename B.S. Imago. B.S. is short for boss.
Sehr interessant. Und irgendwie auch besessen, oder?
Huey called that gigantic unmanned chopper a chrysalis. Is that another one of your AI code names?
Yes. You're referring to the TJ Chrysalis 6000. There's also the GW Pupa 5000, the TR Cocoon 7000.
I get it. A hovercraft type and a treaded type. And those letters on the front. TJ, GW, or whatever. Those are initials.
Correct. The initials of the American presidents whose faces are carved into Mount Rushmore.
Then you're missing
one. Ah, yeah.
I assigned that one to the reptile pod. A.L. Aurelia 8000.
Aurelia. Another word for chrysalis. A pupa just before it emerges.
All of the initials, except for B.S., were of Coldman's choosing. I chose mine from the storied ranks of British royalty. M.S., A.V., E.W.
What do those stand for?
You can't guess. Why, Mary Stuart, Alexandrina Victoria, and Elizabeth Windsor.
All queens. Of course.
Ja, welche Überraschung. Ah, jetzt wird's interessant.